We could organize a string of programs starting at Kannur University then, this was actually facilitated by Kerala Higher Education Council, Kerala State Higher Education Council, and but for council support, this would not have been possible. And although it's a welcome speech, I have to thank the begin by thanking the council, and particularly Professor Rajan Gurukul and Professor Rajan Varghese, and also their wonderful colleagues at Kerala State Higher Education Council, who processed all the papers. Saji might disagree. You did that wonderfully, yeah. Everybody. So therefore, we are very happy that this event is taking place this morning. And Professor Rajan Gurukul doesn't require an introduction to an audience like this, but for formality's sake, I dare to introduce him. He is currently the Vice Chairman of Kerala State Higher Education Council in Trivandrum, and he began his academic career as a teacher in history at Union Christian College, Always, and subsequently moved on to become professor in JNU, Center for Historical Studies, from where he came to Kottayam at end of 1980s, and he was the founding director of School of Social Sciences of Mahatma Gandhi University, where I had also the fortune to work along with him for more than 25 years. And after his retirement in 2007, so he worked as Soundararajan Chair Professor in Contemporary Studies, Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. And I guess his intense intellectual activities came to fruition after he left the university. I think I'm right. Which led to his publishing very important books, Social Formation of Early South India, 2010, not just in Latin America. And in the course of his exposition, we will also realize that many of these questions are very live to debates in South Asia broadly, and India in particular. And so I won't take much time. So my duty is to introduce Professor Gutierrez, and as I said, I first met him while in one of the lifts at the Allison Richard Building in the University of Cambridge. So we had conversation, and which we continued along with other colleagues from various parts of the world, and especially in 2018 when the teachers were on war paths in UK. Maybe for a very long time there were no industrial unrest in UK, and this was after they told us 70s a massive teacher strike in the universities, and that was one occasion when Professor Calderon suggested, along with his own colleagues in the other schools, that we can have a conversation on, as what he put as global Kaman Chakra, this sort of questions of crisis which most parts of the world were experiencing. That was the first occasion when I could listen to him, the way he was speaking. And then, of course, I got opportunities to participate in some of other seminars in Latin American studies. And therefore, I suggested that we can have a South-to-South academic conversation starting in Kerala. And now, briefly about his work. And having gone through some of his research articles, listening to him, and reading parts of the book which he had sent me, and I feel that, so the three questions which he would speak on would be, I'm trying to, just being very brief, and I should be excused for, showing it of all its complexities. He has been working on the questions of democracy, development, and human dignity. These are three things that are very central to, the where the politics unfolds in most parts of the world now. So each of those situations, people are confronted with these three questions. And of course, it is complicated by climate change and other kinds of things. Now, he began his career as a researcher in Bolivia before moving into work with Manuel Castells in Paris. And this experience, I would say that is something where he connected sociology and other disciplines. So you get to know about it you will get to know about it when he speaks. And he worked on basic questions related to the social and economic development of Bolivia to begin with. But subsequently, he worked across a range of institutions all across South America. So we have him working in universities in Chile, of course now in Argentina, Bolivia, and many other places. So therefore, there is a great bringing together of questions which Latin American social sciences was developing. And also, he is part of the Latin American Social Science Council coordinating research and academic training for young people, as well as for senior academics. And then he worked with the UN for a very long time. And that's the time when he authored a human development report and working across a range of scholars from across the world, including Amartya Sen and others, especially on South Asia. And he had teaching assignments in universities in US as well as in Europe. And most recently, he was part of the, he worked as Simon Bolivar Chair, visiting professor at the Center of Latin American Studies, University of Cambridge. So it's a long list of accomplishments that he had, publishing 22 books and also editing 34 volumes on various aspects of economic development. And it's not, one thing which is quite interesting to me is the way in which he would combine, you know, for example, historical scholarship. He would say that some of these, especially related to Latin American development and transformation, could not be spoken without looking at the histories of colonialisms. And therefore, we have in him a sociologist who combines a variety of disciplinary regimes and trying to work across a number of research questions. And subsequently, as I said, he has been working on this significant questions of modernity. So I guess all these questions, which he has been working as a sociologist, as well as somebody who was working in the area of social theory, brought together the human experiences in diverse regions as Europe, Latin America, US, and probably increasingly he is interested in Kerala. So I forced him into that. Obviously, he knew about this Kerala model and other kinds of things much before we met. But what I did was to, you know, share with him some of the interesting writings on Kerala history, development studies, and so on. So therefore, we are extremely glad that we have got a wonderful scholar and a great humanist amongst us to speak this morning. And without mincing much words, I welcome Professor Juan Fernando Calderon Gutierrez to this audience. And so we have here Professor Nikos Parantis, who is a visiting, I hope I pronounced your name at least partially correct, who is a visiting professor at Kerala University, Department of Political Science. So we have Professor Alicia, who is Professor Calderon's wife, who is herself a sociologist who had done extensive work and Bolivia's diaspora and communications technologies. This is the title of one of her books. And she had published a great deal of papers and researches on social imaginaries in Bolivia's urban society. So therefore, we are glad to have you both here, along with other people who have come, Dr. Shivadasan, Paliyara Sridharan, and members of the press, and also the research students and other people from different institutions in Trivandrum, Department of History, Political Science, etc., University of Kerala. Forgive me if I left out anybody. And also the staff of both KCHR as well as Kerala Higher Education Council. So with these words, I request Professor Rajan Gurikal to officiate as the chairman of the session. Thank you very much.
My beloved former colleague, Dr. Sanal Mohan. It's immensely gratifying to be part of this scheme of Kerala State Higher Education Council. Called Scholar in Residence Program. We invite erudite scholars, mainly Nobel laureates, but all areas of knowledge are not under the Nobel Prize. Therefore, we invite all eminent academics with good contributions. On behalf of the State Higher Education Council, I also extend a hearty welcome to Professor Guterres and his wife. I have been developing interest in the way some of the sociological theorists like Guterres, Manuel Castells, and so on have been working. There has been a tendency among many materialist sociologists to do what is called theoretical empiricism, Marx theorization of capitalism, has been a transforming influence on many, and often people thought that we don't have many things to say in theoretical fashion, as capitalism is susceptible to self-destruction. But that was not enough. Now we find the writings of scholars like Professor Guterres, Manuel Castells, and so on, that another economy is possible, and we are not sure about the actual manifestations yet to come. And it's very interesting to notice that there has been really a lot of development in that area, giving rise to a field called processual understanding, processual knowledge. It appears that it's going to be a profoundly enunciated field, and we will be enlightened by the insights of Professor Guterres in his two lectures. And I know that it's all going to be around what is likely to be happening in society, polity, economy, and so on. A little digressed from the stereotypical track conceived by us thanks to the theory of Marx. I don't want to stay between you and Professor Guterres, and I am also eagerly waiting to listen to him. I invite Professor Ivan to lecture.
Everybody, thank you very much for the Ivandurum. My friend,
Sanal from the Kerala Historical Center. Mr. Professor Nikos Marakatsiani, something like that, sorry, from Greece. Dear colleagues, friends, students, and thank you very much for inviting me to introduce some ideas about my reflection of modernity like cultural network in Latin America. If Habermas says the new modernity possible, people will immediately think that there he refers to the world. However, if I mention the world meant modernity, people will think at once that I refer only to Cochabamba or Latin America. Cochabamba means in Quechua, Greenland. But why is this so? I believe that here is a mirror game in our intellectual interactivity. We have developed in relation to Europe, since colonial times. But there is also this idea, and that is very important, that we are different. They, on the other side, in general, have never looked at themselves in our mirror, which was rendered them a feeling of empathy. Empathies where more life and ideas could have developed. We have grown up with them, but at the same time we are different. Besides, the construction has been Baroque. We have been influenced by Greek illustration, and we have often combined it. Often combining them, creating or recreating a world intellectual being. We have been influenced by the German, French, or the English, and particularly by the Jesuits in the area of education. Moreover, what is more significant is what we have done in from our multicultural natives, African, European, Asiatic, Arabic, Latin America, even Indians, as Carlos Fuentes liked to highlight, the writer Carlos Fuentes from Mexico liked to highlight, sometimes we have also temporarily buried mirror, as Fuentes said. Such constructions is at the same time particular and accumulative. Particular because it has varied according the national, international, historical circumstances, requiring crucial cultural and political change. Accumulative because it has a certain continuity with the time in Latin America, and perhaps here too in Latin America, not everything that finishes is over. That is the way that we are. As Simón Bolívar rode on horseback through the continent, he carried his Emilio Rousseau in the saddleback. He suddenly pondered how to create a citizen without alternating the primitive souls of the native peoples and build a free society. But he also negotiated economic possibility with the English to achieve economic autonomy from the Spain, as well as hitting Scottish rebels to their high life military command. For him, Bolivia, my country, means a great desire of freedom, for freedom. This is a mandate that even nowadays the Bolivians and the Latin Americans dream to achieve. Bolivar looked forward to build an autonomous, sovereign, continental country, to express with realism its libertarian dreams. However, as their dreams didn't come true, at the end of his life, he stated that he had prowled in the sea. Zabaleta Mercado, a great historical writer, used to say that with sarcasm, that Bolivar was such a great politician that from his mistakes, five republics were born. But in spite of this, he left the idea of Latin American integration as a utopia of what is possible, an idea to carry out, an idea that is rooted in our future, and they make us think what are and what is possible to be done. The best Latin American Baroque creation, which developed especially in the 18th century, is an act of anti-colonial modernity. I will repeat because for me is the key idea of my speech. The best Latin American Baroque creation, which developed especially in the 18th century, in the origins, is an act of anti-colonial modernity. Since it condemns colonial power and combines the best of our land's vernacular tradition with the best of the European Renaissance and create a social and an aesthetic product that is transcending its own circumstances. Let me develop a little bit this idea. There are two acts that I would like to highlight in the sense, in this sense. The Guarani Jesuit Baroque in the facade of, and the facade of San Lorenzo Potosí, in the city of Potosí. Remember, Potosí at that period is a city who has the same population that have London, for example. Both of them refer to the continuity of historical time as legacy and as utopia established by Guarani and Andean communities. From their primitive experience, they lay that of the idea that a better world is possible. The Guarani communities praise it, for example, in this volume of General History of French Socialists, coordinated by Jacques Drouot, praise it, this experience as a socialist utopia at the same time as Thomas More utopia or the egalitarian utopias of the East. In a didactic way, a friend, Carlos Molina, showed us how the Chiquitanos poets had already discussed the eternity of nature as a source of life. Later, they outlined together with the Jesuits to create a Christian communist, surely inspired by the Cátaros as regards the Jesuits. But above all, the higher the destruction of the new power of the Hacendado, land owing, the idea was each of them, according to their work, avoiding private property, starting from assumption that the development of selfish interests will lead to a religious and social decline in the community. With all of this, they created music in which emerged the connection between the Italian Baroque Cipoli with the marvelous voice together with the tunes of the Chiquitania rainforest. Doesn't this mark the need to find a new ethical way of life against the power of greed? The facade de San Lorenzo that we put there like example, that is the facade de San Lorenzo in the city of Potosí in Bolivia. The facade of San Lorenzo has been built between 1788 and 1744. That is to say, at the beginning of the best colonial art and at the beginning of the decline of the silver economy and colony decline. The first native rebellion were also starting, and the legitimacy of forced labor was also discussed. Let me make a stop in this act. The Church of San Lorenzo was a parish for natives, asked for and demanded by natives to natives, to learned natives, or even better, to natives worried about the Enlightenment. The issue is that a group of native sculptors are worried because of the Renaissance of illustrations and because they are appreciated and accepted as equal in their skill, and even more because they are appreciating as critical creators and reformers of the same illustration. From a genuine project that transcended its circumstances and covered it into a really classical act. The principal door to the house of God, to the representation of eternity, is only a church for Indians. for natives. The principal door to the house of God, to the representation of eternity, the temple for natives, is entrance hall flanked by the god Hermes and its hermaphrodite shape situated on both sides of the door, as you can perhaps appreciate. The wolf aside lies or two caryatides, that is a main central columns, hold in the wolf monument. Thanks to them and to the wonderful Baroque art, we can appreciate the mermaids, musician angels, and the gods, and the sun, and the moon. San Lorenzo, the Burner Martin, San Michael Archangel, the Mestizo, that with his draw, short, and with a furious expression, protect the building as the face the mountain Rico of Potosí, or in Potosí. The cosmology is crucial, and the anthropomorphic features that organize the facade are evident, and maybe it's also the musical representation portrayed into the facade. The mermaids with their charangos is an Indian instrument for playing music. San Lorenzo and the angels with their harps, the Hermes and the Andinan caryatides, is dancing in dancing position in the middle of the Baroque voluptuousness that fills up epi of any single space. It gives the impression that we are affront a wonderful spectacle created by a kind of Andino plateau, or rather the peoples of the Andes that think that the Greek plateau of the Republic or the Timenon from their own perspective. I say plateau because the author, using music, figures, and symbols as the mermaids, deals with the themes of movement of the spheres of the universe, of the form of the cosmos, and the chaos. This is to say, or the degenerative and regenerative forces in space. In this case, one could interpret that the caryatides that represent the native peoples that work in Potosí and suffer like San Lorenzo are holding one of the plateau spheres, the world. It is extraordinary work of art. It is not unique. A series of Baroque facades are painted, as Leopoldo Castedo describes in his Ibero-American Historic of Art. This speaks as well Greek, Roman, and Renaissance figures and symbols, like Wells, although many chronicles show the importance of the Aristotle thought in that period, it is not strange to think that they have also read Plato, a prohibited but more flexible writer, more similar to the Andean cosmology. And it could also be thought the second reading of Plato was part of resistance and not without contradictions to accept the institutional ideology of the church and the colonial power of the empire. In 20th century, there is a group of ensayists and historians that is strongly stated under another historical context the idea of possibility of anti-colonial modernity. The case of Tamayo in Bolivia, for example, or Vasconcelos in Mexico, place the possibility of having a universality of their vernacular cultures. Tamayo, from his Andean origin and his academic training in German and in France illustration, wondered about the possibility of an Aymara modernity. Aymara is a native country in Andinos country. In a more iconoclastic and universal way, Vasconcelos, who was living here in India, did the same regards Mexico, and he even regarded for understand Mexico, India. Let me continue with this kind of examples in the case of Marxism. Marxism was introducing Latin America in a Leninist way. Social formation juxtaposed hacienda regime, capitalist mining economy, limited industrial experience associated with social signification of colonial origins, and limited urban process, summarizing a wonder years of loneliness. Those, among others, were favorable conditions for a language and Leninist idea to ideology to flourish. The Leninist idea had to the people a reference as political subject more than the social caste, and above to try to identify the style, the state with the nation and the emancipation. The state and the revolution and the imperialists, High States of Capitalism, among other books, were texts that inspired rebellion ideologies all through the 20th century. The same Trotsky language, and Trotsky stayed in Mexico, and his various talks about revolutionary from different countries in the continent strengthened the Leninist methodology. Even in Allende times in Chile, I lived there, is they didn't have a good cultural knowledge at the same time of the Revolution of October, he was very hard to talk about the political culture of the Chilean possibility revolution. It is just from the 50s onward, and particularly with the contribution from the published House of Fondo Cultura Económico in Mexico and the group Pasado y Presente of Córdoba, Argentina, that the Marxism reinstalled itself in the region, and besides, it doesn't it in and a very sophisticated way. José Aricó, one of the intellectuals the most and best contributed to the foster this history, introducing a fascinating reading of Gramsci from Italia and Mariatti from Peru as regards social problems connected with the role of culture in culture in politics. In Peru, the controversy about Haya de la Torre and other Peruvian thinkers who lived in Mexico in the revolution period, and Mariátegui concerning the nature of revolutions, are still paradigmatic in the region. National popular or social class revolution was the discussion introducing for these persons at the beginning of the 20th century. In this perspective, there are two controversial acts of modernity related to political and cultural transformation. The muralist movement started by the Mexican Revolution that flourishes all through the region, and the reform of Córdoba in Argentina is carried out by young people in Buenos Aires, young students in Córdoba, in 1918, with the achievement of university autonomy, had a notable impact and modernizing impact in all the continent. From Mexican Revolution, from reformists for the students, these two ideas go through Latin America in that years and has an important connection between one and the other. In the modern aesthetic tradition, as well in the socio-historical analysis, it sounds impossible to understand the Latin American dynamics without taking account the revolutionary experience in Mexico and the three great Mexican painters, the official Mexican painters of the revolution, David Alfaro Siqueiros, Diego Rivera, and José Clemente Orozco. The muralist influence in the Latin American painting expands from Mexico to Chile. However, it is in Bolivia where, due to the revolutionary event of the 52 revolution, the Mexican muralists have their most important impact. The three great muralists relate themselves, on the other hand, with the North American painting. There exists, for instance, a very interesting literature that explains the influence that Siqueiros, Rivero, and Orozco had in the history of North American art. So you cannot understand the art in New York during the 20th century without the importance of the Mexican painters, principally David Alfaro Siqueiros, communist. As it is well known, the aesthetic fact that stands most behind the history of the mural censored in the Rockefeller Center in the New York City is the influence that the Mexican muralists had to the great North American painter Jackson Pollock, who innovate materials and techniques from the teaching of David Alfaro Siqueiros, the European surrealist, traveled to New York in the suitcase of the Cuban, Chinese, African, and Picasso supporter Wilfredo Lam and the Chilean painter Mata. In the Bolivian case, the influence of the Get Out Mexican takes place above all with the direct of a permanent relation between Alandia Pantoja and Diego Rivera, both Trotskyists. The Mexican was visiting the murals in La Paz, particularly those in the government and legislative palace, where were later destroyed. In relation to these events, Elena Poniatowska, a great Mexican writer, says that the Miguel Alandia Pantoja knew how to transcend his masters and synthesize the aesthetics of the three Mexican muralists. Symbolically, it is also very important to understand that Rivera, as well Pantoja, are Trotskyists, when Siqueiro and Romero, another Bolivian painter, were Stalinist. But all of them were Leninist. Following the mural theory, it is a word outlining that is Octavio Paz, who says that the Mexican muralist can only discover its vernacular origin from the outside. Following this theory, it can be confirmed that the insight of the Mexican muralist can only be explained thanks to the connection with the European modernist movement. There is no way to separate him, for example, Diego Rivera from Gauguin. In other words, it is interesting to analyze the thesis of Octavio Paz that saw us to discover the insight of journey from the outside. It is true. And this was only achieved by the revolution, which, by the way, was born from the inside, against the anti-colonial power at that time. Talking in a Kurdish figure for the Bolivian case, we would say that the universal view of modern art that brings the Mexican muralist is one of that enables our painters explore the vernacular tradition guided by another great Bolivian painter, Cecilio Guzmán de Rojas. We would like also add that many of the figures in other greater muralists, Walter Solon Romero, has something to do with Velázquez painting. Those skinny fades, a beautiful reflection with such an attractive brightness and the brightness of the age. And if this is so, our painters are also classical painters because they make portraits of themselves from a critical journey towards a universal past. In this sense, it is possible to state an hypothesis that what is modern in Bolivia renovate and innovate itself with the revolution, but only, and that is key point, but can only be discovered thanks to European modernity that goes through Mexico and his own national revolution. However, and I want to underline, however, the inner part is more important. We cannot separate muralism from mining. Alandia Pantoja and Romero are not self-explained, or they cannot explain it only for Mexican painters. The universe is that of the mine, of the mining camp, of the inner part of the mine, and their relationship with the external world. This relation means a world war of communication and cultural interchange. The mine was the socializing place for the modern industrial world, but it's also the place where the gat Tunupa, now South the Tio, the uncle, resides. The interaction between native culture, work, sport, machinery, and the idea of progress build the mining culture. The miner's ethic is incredible. That ethic that fosters revolution against exploitation, but that values their work is constructions of their own dignity. That's why I believe that aesthetic act of muralism like that that you can see from the from Alandia Pantoja in Bolivia, La Paz. Sorry, I repeat that. What I believe that the aesthetic act of muralism has its grounds in the mining sociability. I cannot be understood without the power of the trade unions, without the tradition of the fighters of the miners, definitely rational and modern. As regards universalists, on the continuity of these projects of modernity, a last socioeconomical event in Buenos Aires was frankly wonderful. Buenos Aires, Argentina. The government removed a great statue of Cristóbal Colón situated in La Casa Rosada, the government palace in Argentina, and was transferred to another place apparently facet to the River de la Plata. This act generates protests on a part of the Italian community, and it is placed a new statue was installed, a statue of Juana Azurduy de Padilla, a Bolivian guerrilla fighter for the independence of Argentina. When they worked, art were inaugurated, thousands of Bolivian and Argentinos mingling, dancing, singing anthems. That happened above the ground below is Museum of the Quinto Centenario, whose principal place art in an erotical mural of Siqueiros, painted together with Argentino artist Lino Inea Spilimbergo, Antonio Berni, and Juan Carlos Constantino, and with the Uruguayan scenographer Enrique Lazaro. It is a beautiful mural with a spooky story. Nowadays, the symbolic recognition of Juan Azurduy is changed. This is the way we are in the region. But that art was a fantastic mix, several countries, mix several arts with an idea of demand freedom. Return to the reform movement in Córdoba, Argentina, reinitiated the experience of a democratic idea of Latin American integration, a movement, a student movement that was launched by urban middle class youths that is intent to democratize the university question, the oligarchies, and launched a Latin America unifying through. The cultural criticism toward the oligarchies was a criticism to cosmopolitans eradicated from the cultural life of their own countries. This criticism towards the European idea of civilization, a sense of Aleto Arwe, cast doubt on the results of plain and chaos in the First World War. In this way, facing this crisis, the students demanding, and I quote, in 1918, in a new civilizing cycle, whose headquarters soul reside in America, as inquestionable historical factors determine it, demands a total change of human values and a different orientation of spiritual force in agreement with an example and ample democracy without dogmas and prejudice. The Latin America idea is spread through many continents in America as the democratic idea and is an interacting destiny in an emancipation project. It reappears in this way, the idea of integration starting in the independence. It is a cultural phenomenon driven to the literature of Aya de la Torre, Vasconcelos, Gabriela Mistral, Rodó, etc. The literature experience was key to construction of that imaginary young Latin American that transcended and combined itself with revolutionary forces and reform. The muralism and other diverse cultural political movements through Latin America and the Caribbean. Now a little bit of discussion about the sociology baroque in Latin America. If modernity, sorry. If modernity seen from sociology point of view at the same time a substantive, historical, and critical reflection of modernization, there are two classical authors who try to combine a Latin American historical culture view and empirical phenomena of continent reality with the classic of European sociology and at a lower scale North America. We are thinking about two exiles, or better, two transterrados, people who go from one country for other country like exiled. Gino Germani and José Medina Echeverría, expelled to America by the Italian fascists and the Spain Franquist experience, were very important. His experience, by the way, that marked from them from ever, both of them working on the relation between modernization and democracy, and also on the explanation of the populist national popular phenomena in the region. For Germani, his classical tale, political society and in time of transition, was central to pose an important complex vision of change from tradition towards modernization. The curious and fantastic thing about the author is that at the end of his career, in the traditional strata of the democratic transition in 1978 in Latin America, he wrote a catastrophic thesis about the relation between modernization and modern and democracy. Maybe it's very important now for these ideas for this conjuncture of Kamanchaca. We believe it that such relation intrinsically lead to anti-democratic totalitarians. This text is one of the few sociological writings that generate a rich controversy in developing countries as well as in the intellectuals in Russia and in the East. Bobbio, a friend of Germani, ends his comments about Germani books with this phrase: "We are dumbed to believe only in reason. Perhaps that's why we have so little faith." The hat boat plugged the sea. The contribution of the Spanish Republicans to the arts and science in Latin America in the social science in the second half of the 20th century was fundamental. Among them, in the social science change, outstand José Medina Echeverría. Remember that around 500,000 of Spanish were expulsed for Spanish, an important part of them, almost the half, coming to Latin America. One of them was this person. But remember, please, too, 2,000 Latin Americans go like volunteers to fight and die in Spain in the Republic experience. A disinvolved Medina Echeverría thought produced a conceptual networking associated the Weberian rationalists with historic of Latin American and so-called Economic Commission for Latin America, CEPAL, a development theory. Here, there is a particular important aspect to highlight that is true about the development by ECLA or CEPAL, and particularly by the concept between the economists Raúl Previte and Medina. They connect the Keynes theory and the sociological Weberian view, In this way, one of the richest and more creative ideas about the development is a kind of English, German, and Latin American Baroque, which in many aspects is similar to the ideas from their aesthetic experience by Amartya Sen and Mahbub ul Haq in their approach of European development many years later. Nevertheless, from my point of view, Medina, one of the most important texts of Medina, The Social Problem in the Economic Development of Bolivia, create the first socio-historical approximation of such approach. That is to say, the Bolivian Revolution was object of empirical, historical, and critical analysis that enabled a leap in the author's theory. In my view, the text anticipates what then becomes Medina's most redefined thought about development in Latin America. A small challenge for a rationalist intellectual as Medina to try to understand a complicated country, a complex country in the middle of one of the most important land-holding revolutions in the continent in 20th century. A country where the land holding and thin economy had structural limits to reproduce itself. A country with rooted native cultures, a mining and peasant movement highly radicalized, associated with the middle class, strongly politicized, and with a strong essayist tradition. A dramatic country that they discovered itself in the Chaco War, and a country where of all phantoms of Hacendado and the patriarchal order tended to recycle or recite in the emerging political culture. From the sociological perspective, Medina accepted the challenge and wrote one of the most important analytic works that shows the social modern drama of the Bolivians in the time of revolution. Crisis and change, on the other hand, not only constitute the pillar of life that shaped in Europe and America America Medina's thought, but also a fundamental ethos in the sociological true modernity. Medina was principally worried about the social condition of the economic development. In this view, it could be understood as expression of the general process of rationalization of modern society. He understood the economic development as a permanent process of accumulation that implies the reiterative investment in the surplus associated with a constant expansion of production. Consequently, what should be studied are the conditions to make his expansion possible. And this is what to try to do with his study, detect the obstacles that the Bolivian social strata posed to the economy development from a rationalist code. From the ECLA theory of modernization in the 60s, the critics and theories about the relationship between dependency and development was born. However, both theories, the developmentist and the dependent, in their variation, they are way of analysis, analysis although they have different canons. On one hand, they are not just different theoretical visions, but their orientation values are usually different. Some are more structural historicists, and others are related with Marxist tradition. However, in the variety of interpretation and political orientation, it is possible to find a common feature in the similar use in the concept of a structure, which appears to be, from my view of view, too abstract and partial. This comes together with an absence of synthesis of significant realities impoverishing the same idea of meaning of social facts. The synchrony analysis doesn't offer more than a skeleton, and the social reality is not just a structure. Perhaps, only Cardoso and Fallet in their book Dependency and Development made a syncretis between the historical structural method and neo-Marxist sui generis through his analysis of dependent situation, where they categorized the diverse national experience and where politics played a significant role. But even in their image, in their emphasis was centered in the structural analysis on the historical process. The analysis of the social historical conflict, the social actors and movements were very limited and subordinated to the logic of developments or politics. The relationship between actor and structure in the analysis was very, very limited. Modernity does not rest in a unique principle, and even less in the simple destruction of the obstacles that oppose reason. Modernity is the dialogue between reason and subject. Without reason, the subject looks itself up in his obsession of identity. Without the subject, reason becomes the instrument of power, said Afrey. Finally, let me talk about the actual situations. So we see some general historical perspective analysis. In the beginning of the 21st century, Latin America was able to reach significant advance of democracy and social integration. For the first time in history, the region experienced, not without problems, more than 30 years of democratic life, but also a significant decrease of poverty above all the so-called extreme poverty, and also experimenting an important revaluation of a regional integration, more political ideological than of development. However, its form of integration in the area of information were limited to a notable expansion of consumption and information and communication technology, and the new experience of informational change of an extractivist of natural resource that renewed his membership in the global market, but that didn't permit genuine productive transformation with equity. All this with important costs and environmental resistance about all those called native peoples. We, the Latin Americans, still haven't learned to sail against the wind, to combine genuine competitiveness with equity and environmental sustainability. We have not been able to live together with a political and cultural pluralist institutionalization and the best way to solve conflicts on options. Sometimes it seems that the old legacy of Hacienda lives in the political culture in the minds of the political elites in the region. And all this in the middle of a change in a multidimensional global crisis that makes more necessary new practical and analytical skills, and that reorganize with uncertainty destinies and with enormous risk the new global geopolitical context. Risks where the actors of power have multiplied themselves and made more complex in the new and still back structure of domination. The truth is that the globalization redefines itself, and this already has important consequences for the entire regions and for each country. In the end, what is national is less important, and there is still a national development task pending. And above all, a practice of integration to have a better position and a vision in today's world. The thought needs to be historical, parochial, anti-colonial, national and local, but if it isn't global and universal as well, it is insufficient. We will stop repeating what the last thinker in vogue says in Europe, or the old obsolete ideological discourse, or even worse, the empiric, not historical narration with analytical and theoretical top context that sustain them. The globalization crisis is a new file of power and conflict. The Latin American intellectuals are becoming conscious that there is an epistemological rupture, and we need more mirror to look a global world. Otherwise, we won't understand, for instance, that a financial crisis in China will affect people in daily life in Cochabamba, and in a movement for dignity of human rights doesn't work and live in the network is very harsh limit. The theoretical path is not made only with memory. The renovation related to the uncertainty on the global change is essential. The emergence of a new actor with a new capacity of agency towards informational development that will enable to sail against the wind is fundamental, although it is still limited. We live the time of Kamanchaka, a very complicated time. As the Andinos miners says, when a terrible fox appears and penetrates their lives, work, and spirit, it is risky. If you move or if you don't, the only thing that remains is to resist and be patient. interesting thing is that they figure a new typical Andean culture. In Germany, for example, there is a wind called Fong, which has similar effects. And auto science already studied the physical and geological characteristic of this ecological phenomenon. The Germans get depressed and are afraid and schizophrenia and suicide. On the Canarias island, there is also a strange mist, and the Canarian citizens lock themselves in their houses to pray. These winds blow everywhere. The culture pessimist shows that the vision of progressive history of rise time is over. The social progress says that Stinner says implies dialectic of the concomitant arms that progress destroy the irreparable equilibrium between society and nature, and beside indecent commodity of development society coexists with what seems to be endemic debt by anger in most part of the world, the social disparity not only rise but income complex. From the perspective that I propose in this essay, the priority is that the life what doesn't imply living outside the rational part of man, only as life, as we were writing with Cristina Micheli, the real embodied itself with a sense of participation, identity, difference, finitude, and an authentic social change. Only from the faith is built and the economic and sociability liberating, transforming can be built. The democratic order is essentially conflictive, and knowing this, we aim and order that it is in own dynamic support and project at the same time a dignified life. For Finnish nowadays, the principal will that the region process for itself and the world in its varied and complex intercultural networks, and the conviction conviction that it is needed to face the change is both memory and criticism of our own history. Bolivar integrationist dreams are necessary on today. They are redefining in the light of the new globalization. Finally, the great creation that we needed now is still the sense of change. Thank you very much.
Familiar with Latin America in the context of liberation theology. And to my knowledge, over the continent, over the universe story, the only religious content that came to transform the society came from the Latin American context. We are living in Kerala with religion being the most negative force for the transformation of the society at large. So I know it from that point of, and I found your name Gutierrez, I mean theologians who were Gutierrez and others. I don't know if you belong to that same. I'm just questioning, what's the position of the nation today in terms of the religion contributing to the transformation of the society?
I'm always recollecting my memory that Latin America that reflects the three ponderous civilizations of the world, the Incas, Aztec, and Mayans. And we can see Pizarro, Cabral, all they came seeking for Aztec gold. And such a great tradition of civilization that was being even forgotten by the people of Latin America. As you said, we need to flow against the upcoming currents of globalization as a West-dominated form. I ardently believe that it is not from the part of a state or such authority, but from the part of the people who are ruled by, they have to take consciousness. I am recollecting the veil of ignorance theory propounded by John Rawls, where the people are unaware about the upcoming situations, the forthcoming situations of the future. So, how much conscious the people of Latin America about the global tendencies, what happening in the global era, and how they can resist against it while they are under a hegemony from a world police.
In this precisely conjunctural discussion in Latin America, we have not only but principally three technocratic economies, or three economic lines for understand and discuss the economical situation in Latin America. One of them is connected with the structuralism, with Keynes theory, with theory that we work principally at ECLA for all Latin America, but it's in Brazil, it is in Mexico, and so on, and in some way are connected with the developmentist, with the integrationist economist. Previch is one of the most important, probably you know it, in the past. Fernando Faisilver write an excellent book that compare Asia with Latin America between 30 years, what happening in the economy and what happening in equity, social transformation with equity, was the name of the book and ECLA results. Another part is the influence of human development approach with the influence from somebody from India, that is Amartya Sen. Amartya Sen works in some sense, as you know very well, some mixed entre structuralism and liberal thought, but put emphasis in freedom as the principal force of democracy. That is one group. Of course, there are differences between them, of the economists. The second group are the neoliberal, are directly connected with the Chicago School of Economy. And they were and are very important in the technocratic area in all the countries in Latin America. You cannot understand the neoliberal experience that we have in all the countries in Latin America, not Cuba, but the rest of the countries, who signed the consensus of Washington without this neoliberal economist. In some sense, now we have another moment for the neoliberal economy in the majority of the countries in Latin America. But probably they fail it again. Now in Argentina we live a key crisis product of that neoliberal politics. There are in some way or another force of the discussion that is the Marxist economist who tried to rethink the development in Latin America from a Marxist politics economy of the transformation. They are the three type of economies that we have in Latin America. Of course, it depends on the country and so on, but in general is that. It's Chicago boys against the structuralists is the principal fight between the economies in Latin America. The other question is very important. We have, in very, very, very general perspective, around our history, two important trends vis-a-vis the Catholic Church, who was the most important religion in Latin America. One of the trends is connected with colonial power. It's connected later with the liberal system. It's connected with the dictatorship, was connected, etc. That is one very important conservative tradition in the church. Another is connected with communitarism, and principally is related with the Jesuits. The experience, how I underline here, the experience of this communitarian communist in the Chiquitania area, in Santa Cruz, Ecuador, Paraguay, and other countries, was a very important influence in the construction of the socialist utopia
in economy, but was introduced connection between the Jesuits and the natives of that. That is a key issue. For example, I cannot understand the Pope now if I don't understand the tradition of the Jesuits, not only in Latin America, at the global level. That is a great framework. A second point that is important in the actual terms, the role who play in the dictatorship period, the church, not always all the church in all the countries, but in some important countries, the role who play the church and the priest to reinforce human rights and to help the people of prison. That's what happened principally in Chile, in Bolivia, in Peru, and so on. You put the name of Gutierrez, my friend. Gutierrez, an excellent thinker in Peru, he write one of the most important books about liberation theory at that moment. So liberation theory is part of the social transformation that we have for in the democratic fight against dictatorship and for fight for a new democracy in Latin America. That is a second important trend. A third important trend for me is in the social movements today. In the social movements today, one of the, I will retake because it's the other question, is one of the important point is the ethics in social transformation. And the, in that ethic of social transformation play an important role the religion, not only the Catholics. Why? Because we live now at global level, and particularly in Latin America, a crisis of the legitimacy of the Catholic Christian at global level. The decrease of the Catholic religion in Latin America in the last 20 years, if I remember well, became from 80-90% at 10 years ago to 70% today. And increase the Christians. That is the trend in Latin America. Increase the Christian church and decrease the Catholic church. In that crisis, always 70-75% of the population are Catholics. But nevertheless, is an important crisis of the institutional framework of the Catholic church. That is the reason why Papa, the Pope, the Francisco Pope, is a charismatic leader who comes from the Jesuits and from the slums of Argentina to want to redefine not only the Catholic religion in Latin America at the global level. It's complicated, but it's the challenge that he has and the Catholics have. Nevertheless, all Latin America society are very religious and connect one religion with other religion in the political culture of religions. For example, we have some culture, probably similar with you, connected with the land we call Pachamama. Pachamama mix the idea of Virgin Maria with the old God of our Andino tradition. Pachamama is the land. Pachamama is the life. And when the Spanish come, land and life is our country. And this is the idea of Virgin Maria too. So Virgin Maria plays in all Latin America with different names a key issue in our everyday culture. It's the mother. It's the mother of the guy who come from Spain. Is the mother of the mestizo people, is the mother of Indian or native who was expulsed from his land. So Virgin Maria is a key issue in the popular culture of everyday life of the Andino society. Even if I not believe in God, something in my heart is connected with this tradition and it's mixed. I mentioned the idea, for example, of Tunupa. Tunupa is agate in our Aymara tradition and Quechua tradition. Is agate of is agate of liberty, of sexual liberty, no? And he fight with another god. He lose and he goes to the mines and lives in the mines. When the miners working class go to work there, always, now today, always go and to pray to the god Tunupa, but they out and pray to the Virgin. That is the connection that we have in our daily life. Nevertheless, the crisis of the Catholic, the institutional crisis of the Catholic Church is very high there, and we don't know the future. Okay? And the third question is connecting in part with the other question. Of course, in Latin American culture, we are, how I say, multicultural. There not exist only a culture of Latin America. Latin America itself is a multicultural. Of course, we become we become from the culture of Andinos culture, of Maya culture in Mexico, and so on, or Amazonia's culture, people from other part. They are natives, origin people. But at a time, there are a plenty of migration of African people to Latin America who become a slave and are part, an essential part of our identity. Even the Europeans become mixed with us. People from Asia and so on, like every part of the world, we live in a multicultural society. The problem is how we connect and we can build a pluralist system where different people can connect it. 50% of the Brazilians are Afro-descendants. And the most poorest people in Latin America are from the Afro-descendants and from the native people. It's a very, very complicated situation. Nevertheless, now we have in this coyuntro today in Latin America, three important social cultural movements try to find a new alternative for the global international crisis. One, and perhaps the most important, is the women movements in the principal cities of Latin America. Another is the ecologist movements, principally between the people who come from the native society, territorial movements, and ethnic movements connected with young people. All this rebellion, all these social conflicts, all this mobilization at time connect, in my view, connect the demand of dignity with demand of human rights, human rights in a unified perspective. And that put like answer to the economic situation, the ethics, like answer to the Kamanchaka problem. How we can rebuild our everyday life if we cannot choose the possibility of other life similar to European society. The study of United Nations in 2009, the Human Development Report that shows if how I said the other day, if the rest of the world want to live and live like the American people live today, North American people live today, the world will be finished 9 times. It is impossible because the contamination and the trains of the disparity that we have. So we must, it's obligatory to find new ways of life. And the social movement showed to us these ethical demands for think, principally in a new way the economy and the politics. But in terms of politics and in terms of sociology, my camp, they are not answered at the moment. They are this answer from the society, fragmented. It's not a big social movement. They are answered to the uncertainty and to the crisis. The dimension of the complexity is so hard that the politicians don't understand what happened. And they believe they understand, but they don't understand. You cannot understand what happened the tomorrow in Kerala if you don't understand what happened at global level.
Please, how you use art as an example of a place where multiple cultures come together was beautiful, which brought to my mind the question, now most of the art forms that reach us from Latin America, they seem to have a really dominant brand of machismo in it, machismo culture. So I was wondering what aspect of Latin American modernity fuels this machismo culture? Is it something that's modern? And if it's not, what kind of, is it something of Andean origin? Is it something from the mining culture? What is the ingredients that goes into this machismo that is part of the Latin American culture?
So somewhere along the way, when you were talking about the anti-colonial movement in Latin America, you also talked about the mixing of Greek and Christian, intellectual traditions, perhaps. Now, I was just wondering, if my knowledge of history is correct, much of the migration to Latin America actually took place after the Second World War, most of the migrations. But then when we talk about 18th and 19th centuries, now how do we have this influence? And I'm just curious to know, where does Latin America actually receive this influence from, this strong Greek influence? I mean, what exactly is the cause of it?
Questions about machismo is a key issue in Latin America. Is the strong cultural force in our everyday life along the history. And it isn't only Latin America. It is everywhere. Machismo is a culture that transcends the countries, transcends the times, and it is present, I don't know, in the last 2,000 years. You cannot understand the modern society without machismo. It's a culture who is in the upper class, in the low class, in the middle class, is present along the history. That is general. Of course, it's different because we are different. It's different to be a woman in a Aymara community that be a woman in a city of New York. The level and the difference of the discrimination are big. Nevertheless, the first thing that we must say, machismo is a key cultural system at global level, and it is a very important thing, a culture in the Latin American history. That is first. Is clear? Okay. Nevertheless, we have in the different cultures and in the different practice, different actions from the women to try to change the situation. And I will not speak about all the historical time because it's very superficial. I will speak now. Why now the machismo and the patriarchal family is in crisis now in everywhere, but principally for me in Latin America? The most important is the transformation of the family structure. This idea of the family of husband and Mary and extensive family, 4, 5, 6 child, become a decrease, even in the countryside. The family that counted 1 or 2 children become to decrease. the level of separation of women and family, the women and men in the family increase. The participation of women, like lead of the family, like the leader of the family, increase. The new marriage become to create a new kind of families. My son, your sons, and we live together in the new marriage. So is really a key issue, because if change the structure of family, everything changes. The social class, the political cult, and so on. So the structure of family changes. Nevertheless, on the other hand, the level of criminality of women in Latin America is one of the most highest criminalities in the world. So it's complicated. But at time, we have a better participation of the women in the market work. Even the disparity in the incomes are bigger, 20-25% in every social class win more the men than the women. But the women, one important key issue, increase in the participation in the labor market. So that key important issue. Another thing that we find in our research in the Human Development Report for Mercosur, Brazil, Argentina, Uruguay, Paraguay, we find in the cities, in the young people, an increase of the capacity of agency capacity from all the women more than the young people men. The women have more capacity to transform dreams in reality. Not bigger, higher, but 2-4% better in the cities than the men person, okay? So we have a transformation, crisis of patriarchy and transformation of the structure of the family. We have inclusion of the women in the labor market, and we have these new trends that I tell you. Finally, and that is the last point, the most important, how we say, we discussed the other day, is the starting out of very important movements impulsed by women against the patriarchalist power systems in every part. Everywhere in Latin America, there exists a key social movements. They are the new things that we're beginning to see, and we must understand what happened. So the situation is very bad, but something is beginning to change. But I like so much the history. Huh? You cannot be a good sociologist if you are not a bad historian, but you must be a historian. So I try to understand the history of modernity from sociological perspective. For understand that, of course, we need to have some idea of continuity along the time. Of course, there are moments, very important moments of that you cut the historical situation, but always they retake the idea of continuity. My thesis is that continuity we mixed. At the beginning of the colony, we're beginning to mix the illustration thoughts in Europe with our tradition. But always in a context of power domination, even in the war situation, at the beginning of the colony, 40 million of persons were died from the natives' country. We have around 800 million of persons at the beginning of the colonial. 100 years later, we have 40 million. what kill it, what sick it by the health problems who become from Europe, and so on. So the relation is complicated. But I say there are other way to understand this relation. The way that the native people and the African people react against the power, one of the ways is to rethinking the illustration problem, to rethink his possibility of liberation. And of course, always is mixed. One principal actor who make the deal between two are the Jesuits. That was your question. And the Jesuits, not all the Jesuits, but very important Jesuits are present. From the Aymara situation and Mexican situation, of course, with a project of power, but recognizing the importance of the language, the culture, the music, the education, and the rationality of the native people. No? So these guys put the philosophical discussion in the communitarian countryside. That was the way. Of course, there are other experiences, but that's why that experience was the most important. No? You can find this experience with, even in the modern times, you cannot understand the Zapatismo rebellion movements without the Jesuits and theology of liberation. And this is a Maya Indian movement in native movement in Mexico. No? So that is the role that played the Jesuits, the principally the Jesuits in our story. Now, at the beginning of the last century, the 20th century, you have right, a new, hola, ¿cómo es? A new way of European scam to Latin America, principally to some countries like Argentina or Uruguay, even Venezuela. But it's a new wave of migrants and retransform the society. It's a very key important issue that you think. We can discuss very much about that. But for example, in Argentina, in between 1875 to 1925, 60 million of Europeans go to Argentina. Stay there only 25 million. But the others come and come back, all come back, and that transformed everything. Buenos Aires became to be one of the most important cities at global level, modern level. The big Buenos Aires is like the rest of Latin America, but the center of Buenos Aires, the principal part of Buenos Aires, is very connected with Europe. It isn't the case of the other cities. Perhaps something of that from San Pablo, something of that you can find in Montevideo, Uruguay, but it's only for some countries. In other countries, are very important to the migration, but what's reabsorbed the migration for the multicultural tradition of each country. Of course, Bolivia becomes Germans and so on, but that included in the multicultural tradition. So there are differences between others. The case of Mexico, the most important city in Latin America, is more similar than in the Bolivian experience than to the Buenos Aires experience. Brazil, San Pablo is a mixed thing too. No?
There are two pictures put on the board.
Yeah.
I'm asking what's your message with those two. One came from the mural in the church. The other is, I think, a painting, a modern painting.
Yes.
What did you want to convey to us with the contrast there?
This is not a question pertinent to the topic of presentation, but I have in the course of my intellectual engagement, somewhere along the way came across this intellectual trend called border thinking, Walter D. McNaughton and all that. We hardly have this in the structured syllabus of our universities, and I really want to know. This is not directly connected to the topic of presentation, but I would like you to speak as a scholar from Latin America to shed some light on this trend, intellectual orientation. There are, must be in the audience, there are people who are quite conversant in this tradition. I would like you to speak a little bit on that.
Things that manifest in culture, and if you take modernity in various places, wherever idol worship hadn't become entrenched, there was anti-colonial power already more or less as a continuation of the existing religion, which never required entrenched kind of idol worship. They certainly had a belief in spirit or something, some supernatural power, but it remained more or less with the people, and it did not require a kind of hierarchy and God on top and so on. But God existed more or less with the people. In such situations, we find even when there is total isolation, modernity automatically acquires rational power, drawing resources from the colonized land itself. That was not the case with India. Anyway, that's a different issue. I'm asking you to respond to this as a sociologist. What was really growing during the 100 years of isolation, 100 years of solitude, using its own resources, and then what really facilitated the process of dissident protest, taking the knowledge base from one of the grand theories which shook the world, Marx theory. Modernity certainly had its intellectual foundation, and that was actually important. Although often people discuss modernity as trends in culture, trends in literature, trends in art and so on, it was a strikingly fresh knowledge framework which enabled a new kind of world view. Although this knowledge foundation or intellectual foundation of modernity was forgotten, I think that has to be okay. So in your area and as a sociologist, now how do you respond?
Okay. Okay, thank you very much again for the questions. First of all, I am somebody very, very connected with Simón Bolívar history and Simón Bolívar personality. I am Bolivarian in my way. Yeah. So for me, in personal terms, Bolívar is not only a thinker or a political actor. Simón Bolívar now identifies the idea of Latin American integration. And that is the principal challenge that we have. I want to underline, of course, we have the life of Simón Bolívar and he's a fantastic person, etc. But we have now a culture that we call Bolivarianismo, Simón Bolívar culture. That means how we can integration in a Latin American perspective equality with freedom. You need, for be freedom, you need equality. And for be equality, you need freedom. But you cannot do it if you cannot do it in a Latin American perspective. And we have sat, and we have in the last 20 centuries, a history of the Bolivian thinkers about the reactions and possibility of this Bolivarian way of think. And of course, there are a variability of positions vis-a-vis. From Chavez, for example, from Chavez to Camilo Serra or to other thinkers in the rest of the continent. They are not a monopoly. It isn't a god. It isn't a religion. It's only a way, a pedagogy, to weigh an idea of future for act in the special circumstances. For example, a friend who was the principal advisor of President Lula from Brazil, who are not connected with the Bolivar tradition because they come from other history, Marco Aurelio Garcia, told me to me, in terms of business, if we make negotiations with the rest of the world with 155 million of persons in Brazil, our capacity to build is less than we have an economy integrated in Latin America with 500 million of persons. We need it by economical reasons and has better quality of deal at the global level with the Chinese, with the Indian, with the Americans, so on. A national, in a regional integration. So we have arguments, a favor, economical arguments for the integration in a Bolivian way, but you have political, ethical, sociological arguments that says that Latin America, with all his difference, is only one multicultural expression. And in the center of that expression, not only the only one, and the center of this expression is Simón Bolívar, even in Mexico, because Simón Bolívar stay only in from Caracas to the south, from Panama to the south, okay? Even in Mexico, the Simón Bolívar thought is very important. For example, one of the principal authors during the 20th century was a Uruguayan called Rodó. He wrote perhaps the most important book about Bolivianism in Latin America. He wrote a book of 100 pages, and the book of the Rodó goes from the south of South America, Montevideo, Uruguay, to Mexico City. The people who make the revolution in Mexico City all read and discuss the book of Rodó, and it's about the Bolivar way of thinking. So it's present in our culture. Perhaps we fail, but we die with that. But we dream with that. The two pictures, yeah. Ponla. We can show again. I can tell you, you see the picture. Yeah. You know, as I try to say or argue here, we have put the facade and we cannot put both, no? No, okay. Thank you.
How do you explain?
No, I explain this. I have one at the end. I will begin with the end. My theory is that we have the last centuries vis-a-vis the project of modernity that the Europeans make a modernity and alignment from the boundaries. And this alignment from the boundaries is built in two manners. One is by art, and other is by politics. Yeah? Which are the principal characteristics of this modernity? Is connect the best of the European thinkers with our historical tradition and build this thing. This was doing in 1772 in Potosí. The other one, thank you, Alicia, was made by Trotsky, Indian, and Trotskyist Indian miner, Bolivian painter called Alandia Pantoja. The name of the painter is The Role of Education in Revolution. You cannot achieve the revolution target without education. And it's a lady, a woman, who lead the process. An Indian movement, a Métis, a original people, a Aymara people. And you know, you see in that picture the lady who read a book for the people. And in the people are the people with army who fight for democracy and revolution, but they need to study. One time ago, I asked to one of the principal leaders of the National Revolution of 52, Presidente Lechín, a grand miner leader, why you don't take the power like miner? Why you give the power to the middle class? Because we are ignorant, and was the answer. We have not the idea of how government. Similar things happened in Mexico Revolution, when Zapata Pancho Villa took the power of the political government in Mexico. They fight four years and achieved to the power. Even take the seat of the president of Mexico. And later come back to the countryside. Don't stay in power. What do you mean that? Anyway, in some sense, this is the lesson that this lady told to us. Without education, we have cannot revolution. But they mixed democracy, liberation, Marxist, because he was a Trotskyist, Marxist, with the National Popular Revolution. And I retake the idea of one or another for this age. This is a Baroque construction. A Baroque construction from the popular people to think liberation. The same thing that the other Baroque construction 200 years ago. That is the idea. So modernity, enlightenment from the South, in this case from Latin America, is building from this kind of social and cultural perspective, mixed. The Andino culture in this case with popular revolution and with the Marxist production. That is the idea. And we have different moments. I speak in other moments that, but the idea is that is one idea. Okay. The other one, and it's connected with your question, which was? I'll finish with that. Okay. The idea that I have and is connected to with the two questions, my idea is we make these kind of things. We build our modernity in a Baroque way for liberation ourselves and so on, and connected with the European and so on. And always modernity who mix two things in theoretical level. One is instrumental rationality, secularization, transformation of the technologies, transformation in the economy, rationality, objective rationality, that is modernization, with values, dreams, ethical. French Revolution connect both things, like the spirit of the transformation. And if you take the German thinkers or the English thinkers or anyway European thinker, always connect the subjectivity with the modernity for his own process of transformation and liberation. We retake that and we remake our own selves. That is the Baroque. But, and that is for me the principal challenge for us. This way to think is finished. Is in total crisis the project, not of modernization, the project of modernity, of the European centuries, and the Latin American idea is finished, is in crisis, because we live in an other global world. So, for that, I say, I can repeat, this is my idea. The idea of modernity that we elaborate in Latin America, connected with the European model of transformation, by the global multidimensional social crisis that we live now, is in crisis too. Modernity is in crisis. Modernization, no. The economic and technological transformation, no. But the way of life, the democracy is in crisis. The cultural way of life is in crisis by ecological, by inequalities, for informational transformation is in crisis. So the question is how we can think another possibility. Really, I don't know. I have only the certitude that we live this crisis. And it's very complicated to understand the crisis. And it's very complicated in starting out of this crisis. And there are not answers from Europe. There are not more answers from the United States. They are in crisis too. Modernity is finished for the European. So, and I hesitate with this one of your questions. So, we must rethink modernity? Perhaps. Perhaps. In my view, one very important thing is to be beginning to understand what happened. Of course, we must continue to understand what happened in the developing countries, but we must begin to understand seriously what happened in the South society. We must understand India. If I thought, I say one time ago, President Evo Morales, see what happening in Kerala will be very important for you. I don't know. If you need to understand what happened in Latin America, for understand yourself, that is my theory. And that is a perspective of analysis, study, critics, elaboration, re-elaboration. That is, for me, the target for the new generations. Perhaps we cannot have a chance to do it, but that is the challenge for me. How we can understand in a global perspective the different world situation in the South. We don't need more. We have a several mirror because it's a global. Of course, we needed to understand what happened in the United States. It's very important. But if we want to understand what happened in China or in India, we don't understand what happened in Cochabamba. And perhaps if we want to understand what happened in Latin America, it's very important to understand what kind of things can happen in India. I think what was one of the reasons why my friend invited me. Vis-a-vis of that, of course, beginning to have some theories very extremely about the border, other theories here and there. There are plenty of theories, and that is okay. But they are not answered for the moment. It's only the beginning of a new time.
On behalf of the council and on behalf of all of you, I wish to hand over the citations. The Kerala State Higher Education Council bestows its highest honor of recognition as erudite scholar in residence on Professor Juan Fernando Calderon Gudeli, in recognition of his great contributions to the scholarly domain of social science.
Thank you. I will go with this to Cochabamba, show everybody.
Okay, now, vote of thanks by Dr. Keshe.
On this auspicious occasion, I feel immensely proud to get a chance to present the vote of thanks on behalf of KCHR. I want to thank all the participants of the program who have been a part of the program. First of all, I would like to thank our director, Professor P. Sanil Mohan, for the opportunities we have derived from the association with Professor Juan Fernando Calderon Gutierrez. Thanks are extended to Kerala State Higher Education Council for undertaking such an innovative concept of erudite scholar in residence program to rejuvenate the field of higher education of the state and to promote various research activities of various universities of Kerala. We are grateful to Professor Rajan Gurukal, Vice Chairman of Kerala State Higher Education Council, for chairing the session. Thank you, sir. A big thanks to Professor Juan Fernando Calderon Gutierrez for his efforts towards the topic Latin American modernity as an intercultural network, uncertainty and new challenges in a global Kamanchaka. It's really amazing that Latin Americans are intellectually influenced by the German, the Latin and the English illustrations and also by the Jesuits in the field of education. We hope Professor Gutierrez and KCHR will keep good ties in future also. Thanks are extended to Professor Alicia for joining with us. I am extremely happy to thank all the participants of the program who have assembled here from various institutions and made this program a successful one. Special thanks are extended to the entire KCHR members. Without our cooperative teamwork, this event couldn't have been a successful one. Once again, thank you all for your kind support. Thank you.